हेलो फ्रेंड्स, सो दिस इज आदि हियर एंड थैंक्स फॉर लिसनिंग टू मी। आई होप यू हैव ऑलरेडी गॉन थ्रू माय अर्लियर वीडियोज, स्पेशली द वन व्हिच आई अपलोडेड वेरी रिसेंटली अबाउट 2 days बैक, एंड देन वन जस्ट यस्टरडे इन विच आई ट्राई टू गिव ऑल द माइन्यूट डिटेल्स ऑफ हाउ SAP प्रोजेक्ट एक्चुअली गेट्स एग्जीक्यूटेड एंड देन व्हाट इज द टीम स्ट्रक्चर एंड एवरीथिंग। सो in the other two videos, I mean day one and day two, which you would have might seen on the channel, I have tried to give more details on basically what is an user, what is a client, and then few other things like how, I mean, what kind of tables we have in SAP, and then what is a system table, what is a maintenance, what is a key field. But then the quality of that video was not that good, so what I did that I'm going to do the same session again on data dictionary, and then we'll try to cover all the aspects here. This session might be completed in two different videos because data dictionary itself is a huge topic. It might be three also, but then we'll try to go through it in as detail as possible so that you don't have any question after that and you can start practicing yourself. But then just to re-emphasize that, please subscribe to my YouTube channel, that is free SAP ABAP without any space, and then you can search it and subscribe, or you can just like my Facebook page also, that is tutorials.sapabap, so that you can keep on getting the updates on my latest videos. Now, so as you can see here, this is my SAP screen, and then I have already explained that what is a presentation server, what is an application server, and then what is a database server. This one is basically this SAP GUI is my presentation server. This particular screen is, it's basically connected to my application server, and then the database server is something, the underlying database. So today we are talking about data dictionary. So data dictionary is basically a kind of Bible for our SAP database. So the transaction for data dictionary is SE11. Again, as I said yesterday, transaction is just like a command. So SE11 is the T code, or transaction code, or transaction, whatever you want to say. So you go to the command area and then just give the T code there. So you'll see all the details here. So we have an ABAP dictionary initial screen, and then options of database, table, view, data type, type group, domain, search, help, lock object, and blah blah. So I mean, first we'll start with the database table. So I'd like to explain two concepts here. We have table and then we have structure. So table is something which carries the data, but then structure doesn't carry any data, it's just a skeleton. So this concept is for SAP database. So we'll be having table, we'll be having structure. At the same time, I would also like you to understand another concept, that is internal table and work area. So internal table is again the same thing, it will carry data. Carry data, but then it will carry the data at runtime. So runtime means when my program is being executed, at that time it will be carrying the data. What does that mean now? It means that data is basically volatile. So as soon as the program execution is finished, this data will be lost. So SAP just carries this data in memory at runtime. So only valid till runtime. Now work area. Work area is again kind of skeleton, but then at runtime it will carry. It may or may not carry, I mean, data. But whenever it will carry a data, it will carry only one record. So what is the benefit of a work area? So for example, I have 100 records in internal table. But then I cannot operate on all those 100 records. I cannot put an operation on all those 100 records at a time. So what I will do, I'll just access every single line using a work area. So for now you just remember these things. Table at database level, it will carry a data. Structure, it won't carry any data, but it's basically the underlying skeleton. Internal table, it will carry the data, but only valid till runtime. Volatile, it will be lost once the program is done. Work area, it may or may not carry a data, but if it carries, it will carry only one record. So that is enough for now. Now coming to database table. So we are having so many database tables in SAP, basically all those standard database tables provided by SAP, which will be storing a lot of business related data, a lot of transactional data, master data. Now, master data is what? So master, I mean, somebody might ask this question. Master data is something which is frequently used, but then it's rarely updated. So example is you have a postpaid mobile number, and then your data is stored in the cell phone service provider. It could be anyone. I mean, like in India we have Airtel or Vodafone. So let's say you are an Airtel customer, and then your data is with Airtel server. So your name, your address, your primary phone number, your bill plan, your mode of payment. So these things, basically we will call it as a master data. So this is something being used very frequently. Almost every conversation these things will be used, but then it's not updated very frequently because your name is not going to change, your address might be changed once in a year or something, and then rest everything is going to be same, your date of birth, and then your social security number or PAN number, like that. So TIN number, whatever. So something which is not frequently updated. So it's basically rarely updated. Now, what is a transactional data? So transactional data is something frequently used and then frequently updated, which means, let's say you get an itemized bill. So every month you'll see the different kind of data there. Sometimes you might make 100 local calls and then 50 STD calls. Next month you might make 1000 local calls, just 2 STD calls. And then sometimes you might be calling your friend for 1000 times and then your girlfriend for maybe 2000 times, something like that. So these details will be stored there, and then based on that your billing would be calculated. So again, it's basically business data generated by you, which means you executed some kind of transaction and then that data was generated. Now, how you executed that transaction? So you executed that transaction using your cell phone, which means you called to someone in the backend. Some kind of transaction was triggered in the service provider system. They started recording the details like who called whom, means you called your friend, which number from which number, and then how many minutes you basically spoke. So this data will be stored in one place. It will be keep on recording this data, and then in the month end when they are going to generate the bill, they will do a reconciling, which means they will generate an invoice against it. So basically invoice against the service they have provided, the service which you have used in form of making the calls. So to generate the invoice, they will also apply the payment plan which you have chosen. So these things which basically happen in real life also applicable to any simple business process. So basically whatever we do is a process. If you go with Six Sigma concepts, whatever we do is a process. So it's basically how efficiently you can manage a process, it would result in a better efficiency and then better productivity and obviously then higher revenue margins. So now I'll also give an example of a normal scenario. You go to a grocery shop and then you buy a few things there. So you go there, you pick something, and then you come to the counter. You hand over the basket to that guy. That guy scans everything, and then the data goes in the system. Once that data goes in the system, in the backend, if I talk about SAP, so how it will happen? So everything will be taken as an order, which means you placed an order for, let's say, one chips packet, two cold drinks, maybe a bread, and then some pastries, could be maybe toothpaste, mouthwash, 100 of things. So you handed over him a basket of, let's say, 10 goods, and then that guy enters those 10 goods details, obviously by scanning the barcode, so in his system. Now, against that, a sales order would be created in the system. Now in SAP, we have a T code for sales order. The T code is VA01. Now you see here, I am writing slash O, then VA01, which means it will open this transaction in a new session. If I write slash N VA01, that means, for example, if I do it here, slash N VA01, it means it will close the current session and then open the transaction in the same session. So you can see here that SE11 is gone now, and it's opened in the same session. But again, since I did a slash O as well, it's opened here. Now this is basically sales order creation. Similarly, we will be having sales order change. So VA01 is creation, VA02 is change, and then VA03 is display. So we'll just quickly try to display any sales order here. So as you saw here, I clicked on this. This is called search help. You can press an F4 or click here directly, and then I selected one option. This is a sales order number. I hit enter. Now you see here, I have these three materials. Let's say this is a toothpaste, this is a toothbrush, this is a mouthwash. So what SAP is showing, that I placed for placed an order for these three items. Quantity is this. This is the unit, basically 55 pieces, 20 pieces, and then this is the description of that item category, blah blah blah, many things will come. From which plant that was procured, so basically from which retail store you are placing the order, what is the net amount, like that. So this is going to be my sales order. And if you see here, this is something called items. Items means transactional data. Now if you see here, sold to party, shipped to party, means basically the customer, the PO number. These things are basically, these things will be called not PO number, but remaining things, it will be called as a master data, which means my sold to party is not going to be changed. And then this was something generated once I hit on the save button. I'll show you how to create an order, but we'll do it later. So a couple of things. So here you have the header details. So header means master data, which means it will not be changed frequently. Just give it some time so that it can open. So yeah, you can see here order type means it's a rush order, which means a quick order. Which date, who created, basically the user who entered it in the system. Which sales office, which sales group, sales area, you know, currency. So these things are not going to be changed very frequently. But then this is going to be changed very, very frequently, which means I can ask him to remove one item, I can ask him to add one item, I can ask him to change the quantity. Many things can be done here. So this is my transactional data. Since I have been talking about a sales order, so obviously in SAP, there would be some table which will store the details of the sales order. So you can see here, I'm doing an /NSE11, which means I'll just close the existing transaction and open a new transaction. So just remember here, just you have to keep it in your mind, the transaction for sales order header is VBAK. Hit on display. And you can do one more thing parallelly. You can click on this icon and then create session. So it will also open a new session. So I do again, I see, oh my god, SE11. The other table for line item is VBAP. You have to remember this because we have so many tables in SAP. Most of the time your functional consultant would come back and tell you the table details and all. But then yeah, it's advisable to remember as many tables as possible. But then, nevertheless, don't worry. I mean, anything can be googled and then you can find it out. So I do a display on VB API as well. First, I'll go to this one. You can see sales document header data, right? This option, if you click here, you can see the contents of this database table. So basically, what kind of data this table has stored. So I was talking about the sales order number 5104. I keep the sales order number here. This VBELN is basically the field name, but then you can go to settings, user parameters, click on field label. So it will give the exact description. So 5104, I execute this. So you can see here, I'm getting all the details at header level, which I was able to see in the transaction. Like if you double click, it will give more details here. Similarly, if I come to this, I try to see the contents of the table. Here also I need to give the order number. Execute this, you can see three items, right? 10, 20, 30. 10, 20, 30, same material, quantity, everything you can see. See, you can see everything, right? So this one is my line item, means transactional data. This one is, this one is my header, that is, that will contain most of the master data. Now, obviously the sales order number will keep on changing every time we hit a save button. But then many of the things will remain same. Now, since we're talking about this, so we'll discuss this table itself. So you can see here, whenever you go in SE11 and try to display a table, the first thing you can see the attributes. So this table was basically created or last changed by SAP in 2005. This is the package. Now package is basically a kind of grouping. So basically it's a grouping of a similar kind of object. So to see a package, what you can do, you can go to /o/SEAT. So it might take some time. Now, language, basically it was originally created in German. So here SEAT, this is called Business Object Navigator. You can go and select the package here. You can hit VA, you can enter VA and then hit enter. It will take some time. Meanwhile, we'll see what else we have here. So delivery and maintenance, this is the description of the table. Still compiling. So this one is in IDA system, basically a demo system, and then server is in my laptop itself. So it's a little slow. Normally in real time it's fast. So here you can see all the objects which are related to this package, they are assigned. I mean, you can just go to SE11 and SE8 and then you can see here. So dictionary objects, you can click and then database table, and then obviously you'll be able to see VBAK here. So you can get the concept right. Now, you can see it's an application table, which means it will store the master and transactional data. If I hit F4, apart from master and transactional data, we have system data, but then system data we don't access and then we don't disturb actually. Most of the time basis guys will take care of that. Basically it will be like setting some parameters which will impact the system performance. So we don't disturb that. You can see system table here. So we have application table, which will store my master and transactional data, that is header and item. Then we have a customizing table, which means it can be maintained only by the customer. So customizing table is something like you are trying to change the settings of a particular transaction, which means SAP has already provided some setting for this standard transaction, but then you want to tweak some of the settings. For example, you want to do a default setting that whenever we enter in VA03 and hit enter, it should pick the maybe something like the payment terms by default. The payment terms is very similar to our billing plan. There also we agree that okay, once you prepare the invoice, we will make the payment within this much of time. So it will just pull it automatically, something like this. So you do a setting in the sorry, in the backend. We'll go back to the table. Storing temporary data L, which this is not used that much. Protected against SAP update, we don't use that much. Control table, system table, we'll just ignore for now. Just focus on A and C. So most of the time, I mean, I would say 80% to 90% of the time, you will come across an application table, but then maybe 10% of the time it could be a customizing table. Customizing table would be most of the time will be accessed by functional consultants, not us, means the technical consultants. Now, coming to the fields. I'll be back in. So coming to the fields, basically, these fields would represent the content which this table is going to store. Now, you can see here that we have an option of key field, which means this particular field and this particular field is going to be a unique entry in this table. What I'm trying to say is that at one particular time, there would be only one unique sales order or a sales document number existing in this particular client. So client concept I have already explained in my previous video, maybe day one or day two you can see. So right now we are working in this particular client. So you can see client 800, which means in client 800, at one particular time, there would be only one sales order with a particular number. For example, we have a sales order number 1501. Then there would be only one sales order number with 1501. There can't be another sales order number with that. So that is something to take with the uniqueness of the record. And then this uniqueness actually helps in terms of improving the performance of the table. And then it also gives some meaning to this table. For example, if we don't have a key field here, then how we are going to access the table? That is not decided. Due to this, when you try to access the data based on any of the selection criteria, system would take a lot of time to search for that data. So now there could be another scenario. For example, anyway, so key field is going to improve the performance of data selection. For example, if I go and try to access the data here, I give the same sales order number 5104 and execute, it will pull the data very quickly. But then if I want to fetch the data based on some other criteria, let's say you can see a document category HC, or maybe this date, document date is 35/1997. Let's say I'm trying to get this one. We'll do one thing, we'll keep some other criteria. Let's say here I'm hitting F4. Like some other sales organization, and then try to execute. So comparatively, it will take more time. Now this one is a demo system, so it's not having that much data. So you can see a quick result here, but in real time in the production, where you'll be having lakhs and lakhs of sales documents, it will take a lot of time. Now, There could be a scenario wherein I need to fetch the data based only based on the sales organization, or maybe sales organization and then distribution channel, some other bit. Now SAP has provided me only one option for performance perspective, that is sales document number. That is my key field. But then there is another option of creating a secondary index. So here you can see indexes. Already SAP has provided few other secondary indexes. So if I take this one, double click here. Was created by SAP, it's active, this date. Yeah, so you can see that based on the creation date also we can fetch the data quickly. Why? Because we have a secondary index available that is active. Again, I'll double click. But then you can see index does not exist in the database system Oracle, which means this index should not work. This index would not work till the time it actually exists. So I'll go back and then. So what you need to understand here is, with the primary key, a primary index would be generated automatically. But then, if you need any other criteria for data selection, you need to create a secondary index. Obviously, secondary index should be created based on certain criteria like volume of data, and then with what frequency that selection combination is used. For example, you created an index on fields B, C, D, and then the data selection frequency is very less, maybe once in a month that is used. Then there is no point of creating such an index. Why? Because whenever we insert a data in the database, in the backend, SAP will try to update that index also, which means primary index as well as it will be updating the secondary index. So what I'm trying to say here is, basically SAP would sort the data based on the indexes and then it will store in the buffer. So it means whenever, let's say I have 10 secondary index, so obviously whenever you are inserting the data in the database, it will try to update all the 10 indexes, due to which the insertion in the database would be slow. To avoid that, we will try to limit the number of secondary indexes as much as possible. So that's about primary and secondary index. You can come here to entry and help check. So you can see we have a concept of check table. So check table, you can see it's T000. We have VBUK. We have TBAK. Now these check tables are basically, so you can see that, let's talk about this one, order type. So order type, and then we have this TBAK table. So input help implemented with this table. So what I'm trying to tell you, that if I go here, go to settings, field for selection, at AUART, that is order type. So you can see order type or document type. If I hit F4 here, so basically this value is coming from that T00. Whatever table is that. So basically this is called the check table, which means the field in one table is actually available in the master table. Something like, one second. So TBAK, you know, I'll open this table also. So primary key of one table is a field in other table. So primary key of TVAK is basically, it's basically a field in VBAK. Now the benefit of this is, this one is my master table for sales document type, and then this can be maintained by the functional guys. SAP provides a maintenance authorization for this. So using customization, number of order types can be created, updated, deleted. But then whatever you see here, the same thing would be populated in the search help here. So basically that is the relationship. A1AAAE something. So you can see here, right? So this will be populated there. Now, and all are unique records only because these are key fields. So the key field of one table is the field in another table. So that is basically the check table. Now, go back. And then, domain I'll explain now. Currency and quantity is basically, again for currency and then quantity. For example, we have a sales order, and then it's basically, it was created in Japan. Now the currency on that sales order should be updated as Japanese yen, that is JPY. Similarly, if a sales order is created in India, it should be updated in INR. So what SAP says that you go to this table VBAK, which means this table only, and then refer this field for the currency. So this helps in the system to understand that whenever I'm storing a value, that is my, let's say, net value of the sales order, then that order is in which currency. It's like INR, it's USD, it's Canadian dollar, it's Australian dollar, like something like that. So that's about it. Now coming to the fields, so one important thing here which you should understand is the concept of data element. So data element is basically a kind of semantic meaning, which means for VBELN field, we have created a data element that is called VBELN underscore VA. So whenever you use this data element anywhere, it will represent the sales document by default. If I double click here, it will show the technical attributes of this semantic meaning, which means whether it's character type, whether it's decimal, whether it's numeric, whether it's a date or time, or whether it's a currency, or what kind of stuff is this. So it will take you there. Yeah, so this one is my domain. Domain itself is again VBELN, and then it represents the char 10, which means 10 characters. If I double click on this, you can see 10 characters. So that is domain and data element. Now you go to technical settings. So you can see the data class. So basically, what kind of data we are going to store. So we are, here we have given APPL1 means transactional data. APPL0 is my master data. APPL2 is organizational data, customizing data. So most of the time we will deal with master data and transactional data. Size categories, you can see basically the data range, that is 0, 1, 2, 3, which means SAP would, by default, it would allocate a space of these many records based on your size category. But it doesn't mean that you cannot enter more than those records. But that is something, it will create a space by default. Yeah, obviously you can enter more data, that doesn't matter. So here in this case, it doesn't mean that it cannot expect data after 5800 records completed. It will, but then by default it allocated the space for 5800. Buffering not allowed, buffering allowed but switched off, buffering switched on. So buffering is something, whenever you hit a table very frequently, what SAP will do, SAP will keep the data of the table in the buffer, that is memory, runtime memory. So that whenever you next time hit the table, it will just go and pull it from the buffer rather than hitting the database, so that the access is basically faster. So buffering not allowed means it won't store. Buffering allowed but switched off, again it won't store. Buffering switched on means it will store and then it will help to access from buffer. Buffering allowed but switched off means it will buffer but it won't access from the buffer. Buffering type, we have single record buffering, generic buffering, full buffered. Full buffered means the complete data. Single record means just for one record, means let's say you fetch for a particular company code very frequently, so it will buffer accordingly. Generic area means again it will be like system logic. Log data changes, if you enable this checkbox, so if whenever there is a change done in the table, it will just log it and then you can view it separately. Write access only with Java, this I don't know what is that. Now we'll go back and then, so yeah, append structure. Append structure means, for example, SAP itself has provided so many fields in a standard table, but then you felt a need that I want to add some 4 or 5 fields extra. So what you can do, you can go and then do an append structure here. Click on create, give the structure name this. Give the details, test, something you can give meaningful description. Component, let's say maybe should we give test, then I give the component type as so by giving this, you can see that I am using an existing data element, that is vbln_va, which I just showed earlier, and then it will automatically inherit the technical attributes also. I will just save it. Now the important concept here is, whenever you save a custom object, or custom means whatever you are doing, so it will ask for a package. So the SAP development namespace would start with G or Y. So you can see here, I have given it as G, or I can give Y, but it won't accept anything other than that. So it should be either start with G or Y. If you want it to start with anything else, you need to register your namespace with SAP. So based on your contract with SAP, SAP would allow you to register a new namespace, and depends on your package and all, it might ask for you some money also. I don't know about that. Now coming to the package, let's see if any existing package is there. So I'll try to search with G star. So we have, let's G underscore Brazil. I'll select this, save it. Now it's asking for a workbench request. So you see this workbench request. So whatever we are doing, I mean, normally that would be a part of our workbench request. It could be creation of database table, it could be development of any report. That is basically workbench request. This customizing request, I'll also tell you. So you hit on the create button, give some meaningful description, test May 21st something. Obviously, it should be a meaningful one. Here we are just playing around, so you can see it automatically, it creates a request number. Hit on OK. So what it does is, it will embed this structure in this transport request. Now you need to activate the structure. Parallelly, so activation means the object is final. So this one is activate, this is save, this one is check. So it will do a syntax check if there is any issue in your development. Now parallelly, I'll go to a transaction called /NIC09. Here you can go and hit on display, so it will display all the transports related to. It will display all the transport related to my user ID. So this is the transport which I created today. If you expand this, it will give, so this one is a parent request, this one is a child request. You can see the table name and then table. Basically, we just embedded a structure in the standard table. So that is appearing here. For now, just to understand this. Now, here the activation is still in process because it will activate the standard table also. It's a time taking process. Now, how we move this object in the next environment, that is quality. So what you need to do, once you are okay, you need to go and release your child request using the struct button. Yes, or still that is not active, so it will take some time. Meanwhile, this gets activated. What we can do, we can go to SE11 and we can try to create a database table. So let's say, as I said, I mean, we need to start with either Z or Y. If you, let's say you put A, B, C, D, and then you try to create. So it will ask for an access key. If you provide an access key, which means you are going to register your namespace here. So we are not going to do that. What I'll do, I'll put G, A, B, C, D. Okay, and let's go test and hit on create. Give some description. Table, I said it should be an application table. Display maintenance allowed with restriction. For now, I will make it as allow. We'll see the impact later. Field, as I said, we need to have a key field. So by putting this particular field MANDT and then data element MANDT means I am specifying that this is particular to this client. If I don't put this, it will be accessed to all the clients. Now let's say I'm giving one field here called MATNR, M-A-T-N-R, which means the material number. So I need to go to technical setting, save it, again save it in a transport. Let's say I put it in the same transport, okay, rather than creating a new one. It's still being activated. So, yeah, go to provide the data class. Size category could be 1. Buffering not required. Save it. Go back. Activate. So it gives a warning. For now, just ignore the warning. Listen to, you want to display now. You can see the status as active. Now, if I go to the same transport request, hit a refresh here. You can see that our new table is also available. And it also stores the technical attributes of the table, like master data, size category, and other things. So let's say this is my table. Since I have entered MATNR, I want to also enter the material description, let's say MAKTX. So material description, I will activate this once again. So now it's already tagged to that transport request, so again it won't ask for the transport request. You can just keep on tagging the changes of this particular database table. Looks like this one is going to take a lot of time. So now, if I go and try to see the contents, So obviously there is no data, so it won't display anything. So what can we can do? Go to utilities, table maintenance generator. Copy the table view name, give it function group. We'll explain the function group later. Authorization group, don't keep any authorization group for now. Hit F4. Without any authorization group, for now give it as one step. And then find screen number. And let system propose the screen number. That is one. And then create. Same tier, same transport request. You can see it's generating the table maintenance generator, and then I'll show you the benefits of that. If we refresh here, so you can see the details also. Definition of the table maintenance. So these things basically it will move to next environment, so our changes will also move. So just wait till the time it's actually done. Go to the transition called slash and press enter. SM30. So you can see my table name is already here. Hit on maintain. Yeah. Now we can click new entry. Give any material. Let's say we can give a material like printer. Just an example. Description is also. Hit on save. Now if you try to see the content of our table. So you can see this data is stored here. So for now, for today, just navigate around SE11, try to create a custom table, try to create a maintenance of the table, and then try to maintain the table via SM30. So tomorrow we will try to play again with the table maintenance generator. We will try to enable or disable some fields. We will try to use the events in table maintenance generator, and then we will also try to create a custom data element and then custom domain so that you can get those concepts also. And then it will just complete our table, and then we will move to search help and then views and then structure. So I think we are good for today, and then we'll meet again tomorrow. So just you can shoot your questions if you have any to my email ID, which I have mentioned in the discussion section of my channel, and then I will see you again tomorrow. For now, just thank you and then take care. Bye.